Welcome to Show and Tell with the Two Mortgage Guys. We come to you live every Tuesday at noon on Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Today, we've got Margaret from Metropolitan Title of Indiana with us. You'll want to stick around where she's going to answer a bunch of questions for us.
So Margaret is a graduate from Indiana State University with a bachelor's and master's degree. Margaret currently co-owns Metropolitan Title and has owned and operated several title insurance and escrow offices throughout the state of Indiana. She also writes and teaches continuing education classes for the Professional Licensing Agency of Indiana and the Indiana Department of Insurance. Margaret is a member of the UPSTAR Board of Directors, Board of Realtors, the Northeast Indiana Board of Realtors, and the Kosciusko County Board of Realtors. Margaret is currently the vice chairman of the board of Greater Fort Wayne, chairman of the Advocacy Committee for Greater Fort Wayne, serves on the Education Committee of UPSTAR Board of Realtors. In her free time, Margaret plays viola and violin for two symphonies and two string quartets in Northeast Indiana. Welcome to the show.
That's
Thank you.
Amazing. That's awesome. Good.
That was a lot. I always like it because I know that Steve's hearing this for the first time. So
yeah, I stay back. I don't look at it. Ryan has that stuff. So that's neat stuff. Hey, I'm going to go way off. So stringed instruments. That's cool. You do that stuff. So is that like with Fort Wayne? Is that where you do it at?
You know, actually, I play in Fort Wayne. I play with the Purdue Symphony in Fort Wayne and another local symphony, North Manchester, but I also play at a lot of churches and live events throughout the area. So yeah, I've done it a long time and I don't think about title insurance when I'm playing music.
There you go. That's your little relief. So
yeah,
that's awesome.
Did you start playing as a child?
I was 8 years old. Long
wow.
time.
That's pretty neat. Yeah. You're probably pretty good then.
I'm okay.
I always thought that was interesting. I had friends when I was younger and we'd go over to their homes and they all played their violin or cello or piano, the whole family, and they're great. And to this day, they still play and their kids play. And that's probably a tradition that will continue on in their family.
That's awesome to hear.
Yep. Well, hey, we've got you on the show today. We're going to talk about title insurance. And I know you asked earlier, everybody wants to know about title insurance, right?
But nobody wants to hear about title insurance. All they want to know is how much their monthly payment is and when can they get the keys.
Right. But, you know, it's an important part. It's a big part of the process of buying a home. So walk us through the process and some of the key steps involved with what exactly title insurance is.
Well, when somebody buys or sells a home or they refinance, then a title insurance policy and a closing, they kind of go hand in hand, are really necessary. And the reason is you want to protect the consumer. And if it's a purchase, your ultimate goal is to protect the buyer from any hidden liens or defects in title. So first thing we do is we get an order from a realtor or a lender for a purchase. And we ask for a purchase agreement because that's a legal binding contract, obviously, that everything's put together, including the mortgage documents on. And we start looking at the chain of title for real estate. We need to make sure that all of the deeds that transferred the real estate to our current owner were sufficient to transfer title. We also look at liens against the property because we have to make sure that we pay the liens off at closing out of the seller's proceeds. If there's a lender involved, the lender wants to make sure those liens are paid off because the lender doesn't want to be in what they call second position. The lender wants to be in first position of holding the lien on the property. And once we get all of those liens and payoffs and we scrub the title and make sure it's all nice and shiny so that we can transfer it to the buyer, then we can have our closing. Now that sounds like a super easy process, but I gotta tell you, I spend most of my days working on cleaning up people's title. And there's so many things that can happen. And I know you two have been around a long time. You think you've seen it all and you've heard it all, until you come to work today. And then and then it's always something. And you know, and most title agents want to make sure we can get people to the table in a timely fashion. But I got to tell you, some of this stuff is not easy to clean up. And, you know, we don't make up or and we don't create the liens and we don't create the blemishes on title. But it is our functionality in the transaction to make sure that the buyer and the lender are protected. So sounds like a pretty easy job, right? We just look at the taxes and look at the liens and go to closing and shake everybody's hand and pass out money.
And it's, so you hit on that. And we actually just had one that closed with you guys in Kokomo yesterday that was, had the same thing. We were ready, but it had some issues on the title on the seller side. It was an estate, you know, so the deceased actually had some past due, you know, tax, sewer bills, and then also a couple of liens that were paid off, but they weren't released. But see, they had to go in, but it was you guys that had to go through all those pieces and go find all the documents and piece it all together. And then it's all clear for that new buyer that bought the house. And now he's in good shape.
Yeah. And sometimes, you know, I think that estates are probably one of the biggest hangups. A lot of people think that if they fill out a will, then there is no need to open an estate. But that's not necessarily true. I want to make sure that everyone understands, too, that I'm not an attorney. So I'm not here offering legal advice today. I'm just talking about things that happen in our company and situations that we have to go through to solve them. But an estate can be a tricky deal. I had a transaction not too long ago, and it was listed. And the seller's realtor called me and she said, "Oh my gosh, Margaret," she said, "we're scheduled to close tomorrow and my seller died yesterday." And she said, "What are we going to do?" And I said, "Well, we're going to have to get an estate opened." You know, the minute I say that, people are freaking out, thinking it's going to take weeks and months to do some of this stuff. And that's not the case. Well, she said, "You know, my people don't want to do that. Let me call you back." So she called me back and she said, "I have an answer for you." She said, "We got it all figured out." She said, "The one son who's been helping the dad, and he actually has power of attorney for dad. So he's going to go ahead and sign the documents as the power of attorney." Well, that's a great solution, but legally it doesn't work because the power of attorney, those powers pass away along with the person who granted them. So that power of attorney was no good. So, you know, she had a couple other ideas, but long story short, our closing was not delayed, but the reason an estate needed to be open is her seller owned the property by himself. And so he also had a will, but in Indiana, when someone dies, you know, I don't know if you two have ever signed a will, but one of the first things it says is that A, you're of sound mind, and that's always questionable. But B, more than anything, it also says that all of your past bills will be settled. And so in Indiana, there's a 70-day rule in which all creditors, maybe it's 90 days, have time to come forth and lay claim to any assets of the estate to settle their bills. So we got into we helped them find a couple of attorneys, and they did get an attorney. They opened the estate. It was less than a few hours. A personal representative was appointed, which was the son who had been signing as the power of attorney. And we did not miss our closing deadline. And what that did for us, it allowed the personal representative to sign the deed. The money then goes to the estate, and then the attorney for the estate will hold the money until the time frame has passed for the bills to be paid. And, you know, the other thing that people don't want to pay is the attorney fees. And I can't quote every attorney fees, but I think the attorney charged about $3,000 to open and close the estate. So, I mean, I've got a bazillion stories. And I'm sure you guys do too, of things that happen. that we have to take care of. But if we had allowed that to close with using the power of attorney, or we had someone else sign the deed, the buyer nor the lender would have been protected. And when they got ready to sell the house, any heir could have come back and laid claim to the property, and they could have overturned the deed. Wow. So a lot of weird things about selling real estate.
I had a will filled out several years ago. I just left everything to Steve. I don't know if Steve done his will or not.
Nice. Good for you.
Saying, that's how I did it. I don't know about you, Steve. Right.
I guess I missed the memo on that.
So. Oh, you didn't? Oh, well. Do you have to have title insurance to sell a home? Like, could I, if I had a deed to my house and I wanted to transfer it to somebody else, is it just as simple as signing off on it, like a car title, or is there more to it as far as the bare bones minimum you would have to do?
Well, in the state of Indiana, you're lucky because you don't have to have an attorney to prepare a deed. A lay person could prepare their deed and they could get it signed and notarized. They could walk down to the courthouse and they could have it transferred. So let me tell you a story about that.
Someone's done this.
Oh my gosh, more often than you think. And I think that's part of the problem is the homemade documents and people who want to be their own realtor or their own mortgage person or their own attorney or whatever they want to do. I had a guy and we just finally got this closed, probably 3 weeks ago now. I've been working with him for 4 years. And I am not kidding you. So he was super excited when his realtor called me and she had listed his property, but he wanted to talk to someone about the state of his title. And so we didn't have the title work completed yet, but I called the gentleman and he was super proud of himself. He had bought this property for $2,500. It was the best deal of the century. And he's got it listed. You know, he's going to make $100,000 on this thing. And just he's going to do this forever. And he was looking for a title company that he could send all of his bazillion deals to. Yeah. And of course, I'm happy to be that title company. So we get the title run. And we only had, I'm thinking, probably $400,000 worth of liens against the real estate. Wow. Much, much more than obviously what he was able to sell it for. And he came in to see me. I know we're on first name basis. I think we had a standing weekly appointment for years, but he bought this property from somebody, never had a title search done, didn't get a professional to help him. And now he's stuck with all these liens. And, you know, at first he wanted to argue with me that they didn't attach to the property because they were prior owners. Well, it doesn't matter whether they're a prior owner or not, a lien attaches for 10 years. So he ended up, I got to tell you, the gentleman did work hard to get his title cleaned up. He had to contact every creditor. He had to negotiate with everybody. And after he paid his realtor and he paid us our exorbitant fee of... of title insurance and the closing, I think he ended up with $2,000. And you can buy and sell real estate all day long, but you're buying a pig and a poke if you don't get a professional to help you.
Wow. So he was on the hook for a lot of those debts.
Either that or he was going to sit on that property for years and years and years.
And wait
that way the 10-year period. So then you just like, and then by the time that's over, so.
Right. So his investment wasn't so much of an investment. He actually is now using the realtor now to vet properties for him. And for him, we'll run a title search for him. I mean, the kid's scared to death.
It's almost like a home inspection. He wants to get a title search done before.
Right.
7 days, right?
To make So it's a bad lesson to be learned, but we see it every day.
It's you were saying earlier how you had that one that was like, hey, I got it fixed. We got a power of attorney. And then, hey, I got it fixed. How it's not our rule, right? It's like you didn't write the law on it. It's just whatever the lawyer says you have to open an estate afterwards with it. But it's the same way, right? I do that when something happens with somebody, they might have credit issues, and then they're calling us back trying to see if maybe if grandma can co-sign, or, you know, there's always somebody trying to fix the, or get in there and try to see if there's a simpler way to do it. And there's not. It's when you've been in the business as long as you have, you know what the rules and the laws are, and we just have to abide by them.
Well, when you think about it, you know, I understand that quick fix thing, but someone's going to buy a piece of property. They're going to get a 30-year mortgage. They're going to live in the property. I mean, what's more important than their home, their family, where they're going to house their family? I mean, the quick fix is not always the right thing to do.
So I know people ask all the time, like, hey, when do I get the survey done? Like, they expect surveys. And I feel like there was a time when you bought a home and a survey was done every time. And now that's not necessarily something that's required by lenders, or, you know, at least in our world, we don't see it happen. And I've always been under the belief it's because there was something within that title policy that gave protection in lieu of that. Can you explain that?
Well, title insurance is based on actuarial data. So the title companies, the underwriters, looked at losses on surveys. And most of the losses were not actually against the title policy. So they didn't require them anymore. And Fannie and Freddie didn't require them anymore. I mean, when I started in this business a long time ago, we had to have a survey even on a refinance. And it makes me sad that people think that a survey is a waste of money and a waste of time, because it really isn't. You know, I told you earlier on that I spend a lot of my days trying to fix things. And unfortunately, since people don't buy a survey anymore, a lot of them are on survey issues. Mm-hmm. I've got one right now that finally we have two attorneys involved, but we closed a transaction and purchase agreement calls for no survey. I had realtors involved, no survey, no nothing. We do our work. We pull the last deed of record. We check for all of our liens. We go back in the chain of title. We do absolutely everything that we're supposed to do. And the title that got transferred to the buyer was a 5-acre tract with a house. About a year later, the buyer comes in and he wants to add his new bride to the deed. So we help him. We get an attorney to prepare a deed, and we send him down to the courthouse and remind him to file his exemptions and all the things you're supposed to do. He came back that afternoon and he brought the deed and he said, they won't record this. They won't put my wife in title. So they sent me back to see you. And that's kind of where somebody grabbed me and I went up and talked to him. And I'm like, why won't they take this deed? I'm looking at our work and nothing wrong with it. The deed was recorded. He said, well, it has something to do with the guy that used to own it pulling two building permits to build two houses on this property. And he said, I don't understand. Well, I didn't either. So I called the recorder's office and the recorder said, we're really confused because the building department gave the seller who used to own this property permits to build two $400,000 houses on these 5 acres. And she said, well, we don't see it was a split or anything. And we didn't either. So I called the seller's realtor and I said, hey, can you tell me how much land was sold on this transaction? And he said, well, you issued the title work. Why don't you look and tell me? And I said, I am not kidding. I said, what's going on with this property? And he said, well, you should have used the legal off of the survey. We only sold 0.28 acres to the buyer and my seller retained the rest of the property. And I'm like, was there a survey done? And he said, yeah, we gave it to the buyer's realtor when they presented the offer. Well, there was nothing in the purchase agreement that talked about a survey. We transferred the whole transaction. The seller now has two $400,000 completed homes on this property. and we've got a problem. And the buyer, he's now gotten legal counsel. The seller has gotten legal counsel. And we're also going to need a partial release of the real estate because guess what? The new mortgage also has 5 acres on it as well.
Oh my gosh.
So, I mean, and this is not just a one-off. I mean, these are the kinds of things that happen when people don't get surveys. You know, that's kind of catastrophic, but all the way to the point that we had someone about 6 months ago trying to tear down their neighbor's fence because they got a survey when they bought the property and found out that the neighbor's fence was on their property line. Well, the neighbor never got a survey when they bought the property. Yeah. So, I mean, this stuff goes on all the time.
Yeah, I can only imagine like that, like, yeah.
You know, surveyors did not pay me to say this. I want you to know that.
Yeah. Wow. But that'll be, yeah, we'll add a surveyor to our list for the upcoming shows because, like, we see them from time to time, but generally when Ryan and I see them, it's usually because there's, like, maybe a farmhouse and 50 acres, and then they pass away and they divide off whatever, 2 acres or 5 acres, but... Like you said, normally on that, it's so we can have the survey so we know how much acreage they're actually purchasing for the mortgage. So,
or you can find out, we had one of these not too long ago in one of our rural communities that found out that the septic system on our seller's septic system is on a neighboring farm. Oh. I mean, that stuff, there's so many reasons to get a survey.
So that scenario you explained where the person turns out didn't purchase as much of the land as they thought. Was that malicious? I mean, was it the trickery on purpose? Where was the negligence at on that? Was it the buyer's agent?
I actually think that there were a lot of, things in play. I had a fairly new buyer's realtor and I had a very savvy seller who I think just counted on his realtor doing the right paperwork. And most of the time it does happen that way. But I just feel there was a disconnect because we don't require surveys anymore. I think that everyone didn't understand that the entity that really needed the survey was the title company. And we were the only ones that were left out of the loop.
Right.
So I just think it was a matter of not knowing. It was not malicious at all.
Yeah. Yeah, it gets, you're right. Sometimes, you know, and I think it's just the way people are nowadays. It just seems like they just go hurry. They hurry. Everybody's in a hurry, it seems like. Right. I still like to sit down, especially with first-time home buyers, and try to face-to-face if you can and try to help walk them through some of the process with it because there's so much paperwork involved on our end and your guys' end when you're going through that. Sometimes it's just better to try to explain it to them, even though sometimes it's like a fire hose because there's so much of it.
Well, there is a lot of work to be done, that's for sure.
Is there anything else you guys do in the title services that we're not talking about, or maybe we don't even think about from the mortgage side of things?
You know, I think we own one of the largest not-for-profit businesses in the state of Indiana. people think that we make a lot of money closing transactions when in fact we really don't. We lose so much because it's very labor intensive, and it's labor intensive because we do spend a lot of time with realtors, with lenders, with sellers and buyers, trying to help them get through the entire process and work through the problems against the real estate. And, I almost think we're a counseling service in some regards. We are educators. And we are people that believe in doing things the right way. And some of that can't be rushed. You know, we do have some other ancillary services, like we're called a title and escrow company. We hold money in escrow for unfinished things such as new construction. when a driveway isn't put in or grade and seed isn't done in December when someone's purchasing a new home. We do those kinds of services. We actually help people direct them to attorneys when they need work or they need deeds. We get tons and tons and tons of deed requests. Quite frankly, we don't like fulfilling those requests because a lot of deeds, you know, it just depends on what the people's needs are, why they're requesting the deed, what their end purpose is. For instance, we get a lot of requests on deeds now called transfer on death deeds. It's actually an estate planning tool that is, you know, it used to be people would deed the property to their children and they'd reserve a life estate into themselves. Well, the transfer on death deed has kind of taken the place of that. But it is an estate planning tool. So for instance, my husband and I just did this. We did some estate planning and we did a transfer on death deed to, we have two children. They're not children, but they're two children. Yeah. So we deeded the property to them on a transfer on death deed. And the thing I like about it is that that deed is revocable. So if I get mad at one of my children, I can certainly revoke the deed. Or if our current property isn't sufficient to sustain us, we can revoke the deed without our children's permission.
That's how my will is to Steve, by the way.
Right.
Get extra for that.
Yeah, that's great. Mm-hmm. But, you know, people want us to help them with that. They really need to talk to an estate planning attorney because that might not be the right vehicle for them. But we do get a lot of requests for deeds and we don't want to put ourselves in a position of offering legal advice. So we direct people to their local attorney staff to do that.
Yeah. And that's always best. It's like, we do the exact same thing when it comes to people gifting money and they're wanting to know what's the gift tax, right? And we're like, hey, you need to go talk to your CPA or tax preparer to make sure. Cause we, last thing we do, like you, we don't want somebody coming back to us. So.
Right.
Yeah. It's good to have.
Well, I can tell you on a local level, we've had great experience with your office here. We do a lot of transactions in Kokomo, very, very accommodating, great people in there. They definitely know what they're doing.
Thank you for that.
You got a great team here. We've actually had some transactions in some of your other offices, but we do a lot here, so we can definitely speak.
Logan Fort and Lafayette, we've been to those around through those areas. So.
Well, good. The in staff at Metropolitan Title, the managers and the staff, they work very, very hard to take care of consumers. And it's never about the money. It's always about taking care of the consumer.
They live there, I think. Most of them sleep overnight.
We're going to start charging them rent.
Yeah. Now, I didn't know if you knew that or not. Yeah. They don't even go home.
Right. Thank you for that.
Yeah. You're welcome. Hey, Margaret. Well, great. Thanks so much for spending some time with us. We really appreciate it. It was really good information. And there, you spurred so much stuff. We'll make some notes and just try to have you back on again so we can cover some other topics with you.
All right. Thanks so much. We appreciate that.
Hey, thanks again for being on. All right. So next week, we're going to be interviewing Amy Pate. We're going to be discussing the truth about realtors. I mean, how are we going to knock that out in 15, 20, 30 minutes? Be sure to join us next Tuesday at noon.